decided to step into a unique world of mystery, suspense, and even a little spooky. My name is Alex Matsuo, and I am a paranormal investigator. One of the most frequently asked questions I get as a seasoned paranormal investigator is, what do I do? How do I get started? Do ghosts ever follow you home? I have the answers to that and more. Before we start, if you haven't already, be sure to hit that subscribe button. Actually, and while you're at it, give this video a thumbs up as well. Also, be sure to check out my team, Association of Paranormal Study. We're on YouTube, we're on Facebook, we have our own website. You'll find articles and lots of other things, and you can even fill out an application and have us check out your haunting at home. Also, you can find me on Facebook and Twitter and Goodreads because I am an author. And actually, speaking of me being an author, I just released a brand new book called The Brave Mortal's Guide to Ghost Hunting. So if you want to learn more about ghost hunting after you watch this video, then be sure to check out that book. All right, let's get started. I love helping people prepare for their first ghost hunt. That first paranormal adventure is like a rite of passage. If you Google what to do for your first ghost hunt, you're going to get a lot of opinions and a lot of advice. A lot of it is good and some of it's not so good. Now, I do have my own little to-do list that will help you on your very first ghost hunt. First of all, respect. So first and foremost, you must respect the locations that you're ghost hunting at. You want to follow the rules of the venue and the group that you're ghost hunting with. Now, if you're going by yourself, you want to make sure that you have some sort of permission from the owner or somebody knows that you're there, because you don't want to trespass. Never trespass. If you're not supposed to be there, don't. Just don't. It's not going to be worth it if you get arrested or you get a fine. It's just don't do it. Now, if you're not respectful, well, guess what? The quickest way to get kicked out of a ghost hunting event is to be rude and to not follow the rules. This also counts being respectful to the ghosts. Now, you have to remember, ghosts were alive at some point. They are people. They just exist in a different form. So the way that you address a ghost, if you wouldn't say it to a living person to their face, don't say it to a ghost. So you want to think about what you do when you first meet a person. Like, what kind of questions would you ask? How would you treat them? You would probably be nice to them. Now, if they are a negative ghost or some sort of negative entity, that's a little bit different, and we can talk about that at another time. But for the most part, ghosts are people too, and treat them as such. Next, equipment. I want to say you don't have to spend tens of thousands of dollars on ghost hunting equipment. Most of the equipment that's out there now, a lot of it is just for entertainment purposes, meaning it's going to flash lights at random times and it may not even be correlated with the presence of a ghost. A lot of the equipment that ghost hunters use today were actually used for something else, and they just rigged it to help them find anomalies in the environment. And that's how my team approaches using equipment. We use the equipment to gauge changes in the environment. For example, like a K2 meter. A K2 meter is trying to find electromagnetic fields, meaning some sort of electricity type thing in the air. Your cell phone emits EMF, your computer emits EMF. Anything that's an electronic can emit EMF. So you want to be careful with that. Now, sometimes what helps me is to put my phone in airplane mode if I have to keep it on during a ghost hunt. Other times, I'll keep the phone off, just because I don't want that interference to happen. Now, if you have equipment that lights up, you know, like the K2 meter, a periscope, or the REM pod where it's making noises and flashing lights and whatnot, you're going to want to keep your questions to yes or no questions. If you're looking at a K2 meter and you're saying, "Hey, what's your name?" How are those lights going to tell you what the name is? So you want to keep it to yes or no question. Now, if you're recording audio, then I highly recommend getting a pretty decent audio recorder. You don't have to spend no more than 20 or 30 bucks for your first go around. Some people even use the audio recorder on their phone, just the voice recorder, nothing else. So don't use an app. The ghost hunting apps out there, I'm going to be honest, I'm very skeptical of, because again, they're used for entertainment purposes. So I'm not that confident in the apps, just because they are built for entertainment purposes only, and anything that I may hear in my audio recording through one of these apps, I can't fully trust that it's from a ghost. But if you stick to just the straight voice recorder on your phone, then you have some potential. Otherwise, I recommend get a good audio recorder. If you really want to bump it up a bit, you can even get a really nice mic. But again, this is for newbies. We don't need to dig into like that complicated stuff yet. Maybe in another video. So next, you need to self-assess. So before you go into any sort of ghost hunt, you want to ask yourself, what do you want to get out of this? Do you want to be scared? Do you want to talk to somebody on the other side? Do you want to learn some history? Do you want to find proof of the afterlife? Is there anybody in particular that you want to make contact with? Just answering simple questions like this can help you gauge what you want out of the experience, and it will help you get a better experience during your ghost hunt. Now, if you're somebody that gets scared really easily or gets really apprehensive in an unfamiliar environment, then I would recommend if you are going to a public location, read the reviews of that place just to see what you could expect. You don't want to necessarily predispose yourself to a certain experience, but if you are somebody that really gets freaked out about these things, then you do want to know what to expect when you go. And for me, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Now, if you're someone who believes you have abilities and you look up the history and then you try to regurgitate at that information as if it's a psychic reading, then no, that's not okay. Don't do that. Now, if you do get scared easily and the whole malevolent haunting thing makes you nervous, then maybe look into a location that's known for having more benevolent hauntings. Now, a benevolent haunting can still be scary, but at least in this case, you wouldn't be worried about much else besides, ooh, a ghost. And the reason why you want to self-assess is because you want to know what your limits are and how far you can push yourself. And overall, this will help you tremendously on your first ghost hunt. Next, you want to know where you're going. If you're a psychic medium, then maybe you're going to want to skip this part. Now, being familiar with the location is key before going on a ghost hunt. Even if the company that you might be ghost hunting with wants to keep the location a secret until the night of, all hope isn't lost. So you can do one or two things. You can research the history of the town that you're going to be in, so that will give you an idea of what to expect. Or you can just contact the company directly and just ask them some questions. Like, what kind of environment are we going to? Are we going to a house? Are we going to a barn? Are we going to a cave? Will I have to hike? Will I have to walk a long way? Can I drive there? Are we going to be outside? Are we going to be inside? Now, if you are going to be ghost hunting at a location where you could be outside, then definitely dress for the weather. That means jackets, umbrellas, you know, dressing in layers, depending on how the weather is. That's definitely important so that you're prepared. Now, you also want to know about the terrain, because if you're driving like a little compact car that's 20 years old and you're going to be going over like mud and rocks and stuff, then maybe you might want to see about carpooling. If you're going to be on a paved road, then awesome. Of course, as always, whether you're in a location that's dark or light, inside, outside, always be sure to have a flashlight on you. I can't tell you how many times I've forgotten my own flashlight and I've had to use my phone. Not the ideal thing, so make sure you have a flashlight nearby. You can get them for cheap at Walmart, Target, or even Dollar Tree if you want to go super cheap. Also, wear closed-toed shoes. A lot of times you may be going into some of these historic places and there's still like screws on the floor, there's dust, there's bugs, there's feces from like bats and rodents. You want to wear closed-toed shoes, you want to protect your feet. If you have to go through the woods at all, you definitely want to make sure you're dressing like jeans, long sleeves, regardless if it's hot or cold outside, because if you walk through some poisonous plants, oh my gosh, you're going to regret it. This is another thing. Ghost hunters are well known for wearing black. Don't wear black, especially if you're going to have to be walking like through the woods or across the street or anything. When it's dark and you're wearing black clothes, cars aren't going to be able to see you. I can't tell you how many stories I have heard of ghost hunters getting hit by cars in the middle of the night. So I touched on this a little bit already, but let's go back to tech. Now, tech is another thing I will get countless questions about. Now, like I said, you don't have to spend tens of thousands of dollars on tech, but part of the ghost hunting experience is collecting evidence. I like to use the word data, but evidence is going to be used right now for the purpose of this video. Collecting evidence or collecting data means that you're recording things on your audio recorder, you're taking video, anything where you are collecting information about your experience as it's happening. Now, keep in mind, you do have to review that evidence after you're done. Meaning, if you ghost hunted for 4 hours and you have two audio recorders, that means you have 8 hours of audio to go through. So just keep that in mind when you have your equipment and, you know, you're about to go through all your evidence afterwards. So even if you were there for 4 hours, let's say you have 5 pieces of equipment, that means you might have 20 hours of evidence to go through. It's not a bad thing. It's all part of the experience. And you never know. That's how you find out that if you've caught something that is paranormal. If you don't want to do tech, that's okay too. Some of the best ghost hunters I know actually just use a pen and paper, and they write down their experiences and they go from there, and they're still able to debunk what happened. So taking copious notes, that's okay too. You can be completely tech-free as well. Ghost hunting is a personal experience. If you don't want tech, don't bring the tech. If you are on your own journey that doesn't require tech, then that is awesome, more power to you. Next, you want to pack smart. Now, if you're going on a ghost hunt that will last longer than a few hours, then you might want to pack some provisions. This can mean anything from snacks, water, first aid kit, map, just something that will help you get through the ghost hunt easier. Now, usually everyone will default to sugary snacks, salty snacks, caffeinated drinks like soda, coffee, to help them stay awake. I tend to go the other way. I get incredibly thirsty when I'm ghost hunting, so I make sure I pack a lot of water. Even if I'm going through like a company or a location that already provides that, I still make sure that I bring water regardless so that I know I have water. Plus, speaking from experience, all the sugar and the caffeine, that will eventually make you crash. So you may be on a high for about 30 to 45 minutes, but then pretty soon all that sugar you consumed will cause you to crash, and then you get really tired. The snacks you could bring on a ghost hunt, they're not quite as exciting as like pizza or candy. I tend to bring a lot of protein filled foods, maybe some veggies, dried up fruits, just something that'll keep me full and keep my energy up. Also, finally, you want to pack lots of batteries. I can't tell you how many times our equipment ran out of battery juice in the middle of an investigation, even when we just changed the batteries. So be sure to pack lots of batteries. Make sure you have backup batteries that are charged, or you got a pack of new batteries in your bag. That way, if something does run out of juice, you can replace it right away. Sleep. So I know this may sound weird coming from a ghost hunter, but you do need sleep. You have to sleep. If that means taking a nap before your investigation so that you can throw off your circadian rhythm and can stay up all night, that's great. But I don't recommend staying up late the night before, then staying up all day, and then staying up late that night, because you're eventually gonna fall asleep. And sleep is one of the most important things that our body needs. And getting enough sleep is essential to enjoying the ghost hunting experience. Sure, yeah, you are gonna get tired. That's a given. But if you push yourself beyond being sleepy, then you're gonna start to hallucinate. So the things that you might be seeing or you think you're seeing, it might not even be paranormal. It's probably a hallucination from not getting enough sleep. You start to see funny things. And sleep deprivation can also create a very similar feeling to being drunk. And also, lack of sleep can affect your ability to comprehend your surroundings, meaning you're more vulnerable to getting hurt. You could trip. You could walk someplace where you're not supposed to. And something as simple and logical can be misinterpreted as paranormal. Also, if you're tired, there's no shame in taking a cat nap. Wherever your base camp is, take a 30-minute snooze, you know, take a power nap. And for me, I try to get at least 8 hours of sleep the night before I go on an investigation, and I will take a nap beforehand as well. That way, by the time the ghost hunt rolls around, I'm pretty wide awake. Okay, next, historical research. Now, some people don't like to do any historical research before they go to a location because they don't want to taint themselves. For me personally, I love to do historical research, and for me, I think it is essential to do historical research before you go on a ghost hunt. Why? It's because if you do make contact with a ghost, you will have enough knowledge under your belt and know the context of that location to be able to say, is this John we are talking to? John, is your sister Abigail there with you? So you will have that knowledge so that you can continue that conversation. So that's why I highly recommend doing some historical research, having some sort of idea who the family was that lived in the location, or what historical events happened at that location. Any names that stood out, any famous names that stood out, the year that the location existed, were there any historical events that were significant, like the Civil War, Revolutionary War, the Great Depression? Just having some sort of context you could go with so that if you do make contact with a ghost, you can follow up with those questions and you'll already know that information because you did your research. Now, if you feel you are psychic or you have mediumship abilities, then you're going to need to prepare in another way. Numerous times I've noticed that people get overwhelmed when they go to a haunted location, and usually this is a new medium or somebody who just came into their abilities. They get overwhelmed, they don't know how to process all the information that's being brought to them. Or they're on a ghost hunt and they start to experience all these crazy things that no one else is experiencing, and they're sober and they're of sound mind and they realize, oh, I might be psychic. I highly recommend, regardless of whether you're psychic or not, do some grounding and shielding. Grounding meaning you set yourself, you are grounded, you are sturdy, and then shielding, it's as simple as picturing white light around you. It's as simple as just thinking like only positive energy in, negative energy stays out. Hopefully you don't have to worry too much about anything attaching itself to you. Now, having a better understanding of your abilities before you go on that first ghost hunt will really help you have a positive experience. Next, you want to ask the right questions. Now, with each ghost hunt, you're probably going to hear suggestions on what sort of questions to ask, or you will hear other people ask questions. Now, there's a trick to asking the right questions to create a welcoming environment. Now, depending on where you go, these ghosts might have been asked the same question thousands of times. Who are you? Why are you here? Do you know you are dead? You want to keep your questions simple, but also smart. Something as simple as asking for a name is better than asking questions like, do you know you're dead? This is where your research is gonna help, where if you do your historical research and you know the location, you know names, you know dates, that will help you ask good questions. And questions like, who is the president, is a good question because then you can get an idea of time period. Be careful that you don't ask stacking questions. This means you say something like, what's your name? Who are you? Do you live here? So you're asking three questions in the same line of questioning. Keep your questions to one at a time, and then leave about a gap of 10 to 20 seconds so that the ghost has time to answer you, and also you don't talk over the ghost while they're answering. This will really help you when you're reviewing your audio evidence. Also, you want to be safe. This means following the rules of the location that you're at. You probably will have to sign some sort of liability release. It's there for a reason. Most of the time we are going to historical locations. This means that they might be really old. The location may be going under some sort of remodeling or restoration. So you want to make sure that you have a good awareness of your surroundings. Ask whoever the person is that owns the location or is hosting the event, is there any place where we're not allowed to go to? Are there any signs we should look for? Like if there's cones there, we don't go, right? If the door is locked, we don't open it, right? You know, you just want, it may seem silly, but you want to ask those questions because you never know. Also, we want to keep in mind of the other safety concerns, like what's the air quality like? Especially if you're going into an older location where there's not a lot of ventilation, you might be inhaling dust that's like 200 years old. There may be bat guano, or you might experience some sort of injury like your foot going through a floorboard, or you roll your ankle, or you trip and fall. So you just wanna be extra cautious when going to a historical location, especially. Finally, this is probably the most asked question I will get. How do you keep the ghost from following you home? The honest answer is I don't make the rules of the afterlife. I don't know what inspires a ghost to attach to somebody and follow them home. And for me personally, I still get ghostly visitors from time to time where I live, meaning sometimes things will happen and then it stops. Sometimes I do have something following me home. This could be because they're curious about me or they like me. I make sure that they don't overstay their welcome. Also, creating boundaries is key for preventing a ghost from following you home. This means, at least for me, I don't get in my car until I know I'm alone. And even then, I sort of shake off like any sort of energy from the ghost hunt, meaning it could be energy from the people, from the location, or a ghost. On my way home, I will roll the windows down and let the wind blow through my hair, blow through my space, and I just envision any energy or anything I picked up from the investigation just blows away with the wind. Even when I get to my door, I still shake off the energy. I do some shielding. You know, I just picture nothing is attached to me. And even when I get into my home, I take a shower right after. I always take a post-ghost hunt shower anyway because Most of these places are historical, they're dusty, they're grimy. I take a shower. I put my clothes straight into the washer, and even while I'm like in the shower, I let the water like cleanse my being. I mean, I let it cleanse my body, cleanse my soul. So any attachments I have, they go right down the drain. And you want to set your boundaries. You just say, hey, you can go anywhere you want, to the ghost, but don't follow me home. You cannot follow me home. Just lay down the rules. And if that still doesn't work, then you can contact your local team. You can contact me or my team, and we'll be able to help you out. So these are my tips for ghost hunting for newbies. If you have any suggestions, comments, and any tips yourself, be sure to share them in the comments. If you enjoyed this video and you want more, be sure to check out my new book, The Brave Mortal's Guide to Ghost Hunting, available on Amazon. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I will see you all in the next round.